streams. I'm
glad you enjoyed it anyway. Tell me about getting this movie together then, Nicholas. You produced it. I know that Rob was on board from quite an early stage, right?
Yeah, I mean, you know, my business partner Trevor Engelson read the script and he gave it to me and said, I think it's something you might like. And I loved it. And, you know, it's been a 4-year process and we got Alan Coulter, the director, on board, and then we got Rob. And I'm very proud to say that Rob read the script and then the parking lot of an In-N-Out burger, right? And it was like 2 months before Twilight came out, and Rob signed on and stuck with the project, and you know, from there everything just snowballed.
And so is that there's the exec producer credit, that's the reason for that, is it?
No, I think, you know, Rob always wanted, you know, he always wanted this project to be handled a certain way, and so we wanted him to come on board, and you know, we consulted him on the casting of the movie and on the script and various things along the way. And you know, you're a great executive producer, so.
I didn't even know you were.
It's on the poster.
What was it that you really liked about it, Rob, when you were approached?
I think it was just. I'd read tons and tons of scripts over the summer after I did Twilight, and I mean hundreds, and everything just seemed exactly the same. And this one, initially just about the way the dialogue was written, it just seemed much more naturalistic than most things. And also Tyler as a character, I mean, it seems like most movies which have a young male protagonist as the lead, they have to be like either a virgin to begin with and have to learn everything during the movie, or they go through the trials of the movie and then end up a different person and they're completely fine afterwards. But Tyler seemed like he starts off with a lot of baggage and a very full and developed character and ends up just being developed in a slightly different way rather than just becoming, oh, I'm fine now. After going through this movie, I'm fine. And you just never see that in films very much, especially for young people, with the parts being young. I think that's what initially appealed to me.
Well, I've got to say, for both of your characters, there's great chemistry between your fathers, so Pierce Brosnan and Chris Cooper. How is it for both of you working with Emily, with Chris, and Rob, with Pierce?
Yeah, I mean, I was over the moon when I found out Chris was playing my dad. I've been a fan of his for years. He's just incredible, and just such a sort of a very intense person, but very giving. It never really, you know, never felt like reading a scene. It's felt like, you know, you're watching and reacting. And, yeah.
And the legend that is Mr. Brosnan?
No, so I mean, when they first talked about Pierce, I mean, I never ever would have thought initially that it would be someone like Pierce playing Charles. But I don't know. I think he has a sort of innate likeability to him. I mean, as soon as you meet him, he's very, very charismatic. And, so, and Charles on the page was someone who's very domineering and quite a negative character. And Pierce, just by being Pierce, kind of changed the whole dynamic of it, which was great, and it made it a much more interesting relationship, I think.
He can be charming, can't he? He looks like someone who is rich and is a businessman and can wear the suit well, but he can also charm the socks off you.
He's very, very charming.
He's the kind of guy who you mention you have a great aunt, Matilda, and then you see him like 3 months later, and he remembers.
Yeah.
And he's like, how was her leg operation?
He's just a really nice guy.
We'll brave the lights now and get some questions. There are roaming microphones, so if you can just wait till you get the microphone, everyone can hear you. Immediately, someone at the back is that Joe? It is. Hello, Joe. Do you want to just get him? Is there a microphone for Joe? Yeah, and then we'll get the first question, and you know the deal. Just stick your hand up, we'll get a microphone to you.
Cool. Thank you very much. Hello. This is a question for Robert. It's Joe from Heart Radio. Robert, you're very sweet with the young girl who plays your sister in the film. It seemed like that was a very natural thing for you to be working with such a young girl. You haven't got any younger brothers and sisters, so tell us about that relationship and how you made it sort of seem so natural.
I think that's really all just Ruby who plays her. She's just, I don't have any younger brothers and sisters. I mean, I've got two older, I think I always wanted a younger sibling. Not that I have anything against my sisters, but she's just one of the best actresses I've ever worked with. She's very she's surprisingly just articulate about her character. I mean, when I first met her, she seemed like a very, very normal kid. And then the more she talked about her character and her character's development, I mean, she could talk about it for hours, and she could also just improvise for hours and hours and hours. And was so comfortable in front of the camera and with working with adults. And she was really amazing. And I kind of, it's very easy to do anything with it. You can just look at her and you can know what to do immediately.
Can we get a microphone down to the front? Anne Wobrett has a question.
Yeah, Robert, at what point did you realise you could use your powers for good and through the success of those other movies help perhaps finance films like this? And what pressures are there or were there on you to perhaps do other stuff that might earn more money but be less satisfying?
I never like anything. I mean, and so it's quite easy to decide what to do. And, you know, even movies I'm not in. I've never felt any pressure to do anything particularly. It's like, even when we were shooting it, I never thought about the box office or anything. It's only when it came to promoting it that it's, you know, people ask you about that stuff. And obviously, it's not even it's not like a Twilight movie. It's an original screenplay, and it doesn't fit into any genre either. It's not really that much of a feel good movie, but they don't make movies like it anymore. So, and I think that's how I kind of choose stuff. And that's the only criteria I really have. If there seems to be a gap in the market for something, then I just try and do that. I'm trying to do that with all the other things I'm doing afterwards.
And that presumably is the same reason why you guys were attracted to it in the first place as well.
Yeah, no, definitely. It didn't even read to me personally really like a script, which is probably what you were saying, but it also didn't read technically like a script in a very good way. It read more like just, you know, somebody had written you a letter, or you were reading something that somebody had just jotted down, and it was so honest and organic in that way, I think. Yeah.
Can we get a microphone over here to the second row? Thanks. You chuck it.
Hi, without wanting to give away the end, the film has to be set in New York. So how are you with the New York accents for the actors? And also you mentioned the New York premiere. What has been the reaction of New Yorkers to seeing something that's still quite raw for them on film?
In general, I love accents, and I suppose have to use them quite a lot working out of the States, but it just really adds another layer to the character for me and takes them sort of further away from yourself. And it was interesting with Ali, because she's from Queens, she grew up in Queens, and you know, I was originally sort of thinking, okay, you know, really do a very authentic Queens accent, and then sort of went up there and talking to our amazing dialect coach who was on set all the time about it, and really noticing and observing up there that the younger generation, sort of like late teens, early 20s, didn't have a strong accent at all. And I've noticed that in other places too. It's just sort of dissipating all over the world because of, I think, just more and more constant influx of, you know, media, whether it's through the internet and TV and radio, just becoming more and more, and people travelling more, that it's really the older people who still have that accent. So,
how about your accent, Rob?
I think it just sort of came out of the script. The dialogue, I pretty much had the same voice from the first time I read the script to the way through the movie. Sometimes when you're lucky, you just read a script and the voice comes out right. I wasn't even conscious of doing a New York accent. I didn't even know what borough or anything. I mean, it just sounded like, I mean, I've spent a bit of time in New York and you know, just trying to pick up on how people speak. But it's also, you know, I don't know where my accent is now. I mean, I wouldn't say I have a specifically London accent anymore. So I don't know.
Have you also asked about the reaction in New York to the film? How's it been?
Well, I think, you know, I think obviously this has to be a New York story. We had to shoot a movie in New York. And we had a lot of New Yorkers on set. We had a lot of New Yorkers who have been affected by the events in the movie. We had a number of cops in the movie who were, you know, affected by the events as well. And they all read the script and all fell in love with it and all felt like it was an important story to tell. And so we always felt good about that, that they kind of gave it their stamp of approval.
Right, let's get the microphone down to this far corner, if that's right. Oh, sorry, were you next? Okay, apologies. We'll go there, and then we'll go there. Thanks.
Emilie, Lost has been such a big part of your life for so long now. How does it feel to leave that behind, and how positively do you feel about the future? What's next?
It has been a big part of my life, and it's been a great ride. It's kind of bittersweet that it's ending. I'm really happy they made a decision consciously to announce an end date 3 years ago so they could evolve the story how they wanted to and really give it a beginning, middle, and an end, and also that it's ending on a high note. It's not just sort of trickling away when no one cares, so I think that's all really positive. But yeah, obviously you miss things about projects and people you work with. I guess I'm trying to be positive about the future. Yeah.
Can we get the microphone over here, please? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Question for Robert. Your character has a buddy in the movie, Aidan, who becomes increasingly important to him. Do you have a real-life equivalent, a male buddy that's very important to you? And your sister in the movie regards your character as a bit of a hero to protect her. Do you have a hero?
I mean, it's nice that I've grown up with the same friends since I was 12. I have a very, very close-knit set of them. So people would think I'm a hero. No, I think I'm always kind of envious of that. I mean, I grew up with a lot of people who a lot of other people regarded as heroes, and I think no one ever came to me for advice, and never came to me for protection. And I don't think I've ever really been looked at as a hero.
But do you regard anybody as a hero?
Oh, do I? Do I? Oh,
yeah. I
mean, outside of my family, I don't really know. I mean, they're always, they're great people, and I think that's, and my parents are great parents, and they brought me up very well, I think. I don't know, I think that's about all the heroes I've had.
Gentleman next door.
Emilie and Robert, this is obviously a very different kind of work from both Lost and Twilight, and which both have phenomenal fan bases because they're 21st century phenomenons. So I'm just wondering, how important to you is the reaction of your fans to seeing you in a film like this? You know, how uppermost in your mind is their need to invest in what's a slow-burning story and get to know you in a totally different world, a kind of more low-key, realistic world?
I always felt this the most important thing you can do. It's doing films like this, which are quite difficult, I would have thought, to just generically advertise and get out to people. Having something like Twilight and Lost, like, it gives it publicity immediately. And so I think that's the only thing I was carrying. I mean, if people go and see it, then once you've got them, for films like this, I think once you've got them into the cinema, then it's almost inevitable that they'll get drawn into it, hopefully. And, I mean, I don't know. I mean, obviously you hope people like things, but I mean, I think if you start doing stuff to please a certain audience, then you're going the wrong direction. Because you can never please people by deciding. I mean, you don't even know the people who you're trying to please. So, especially when you're trying to please huge swathes of people. I hope
yeah, no, I agree. I think it's interesting. I think it was never really conscious for me in that way, but, why not, use a pre-existing fan base? But as you're saying, you're not going to please every fan. Every fan of, say, Twilight or Lost isn't going to love everything you do. I mean, that's just, they may fall in love with the setting or the character for a certain reason, for one thing, and just not be into the next. It's more for me just really wanting to do something that challenges me in a different way and not sort of pigeonholing myself in like one category of actor. Sure.
Now there's a lady with blonde hair who's next up. Get the microphone to her. Thank you.
Hi, Robert. I'm Martina from Sugar Magazine. We know and love you for playing the deep and brooding types like Tyler and, of course, Edward. What is it that attracts you so much to these types? And could you ever see yourself taking a more light-hearted approach and signing up to a comedy?
Yeah, I mean, I did do, like, kind of lighter stuff before Twilight came out. And I don't know, it just so happened that, like, you know, Twilight's become so much about, you know, sort of archetype of a brooding person. So, yeah. I mean, I never thought that Tyler was that brooding, to be honest. I mean, like, yeah, every single thing saying, like, oh, just brood, brood, brood. I never even had the word before Twilight. And, I don't know. I mean, I guess you like to play kind of broken, like, troubled characters, because it seems more interesting, especially because I'm not particularly broken and troubled myself. I mean, I'm doing something now, which is... It's still quite dark, but the guy isn't so, his character isn't so fractured. It's someone who's incredibly focused and has a lot of confidence in himself, and nothing can really shake his confidence. And after that, I think it's a kind of lighter thing as well. I don't know. I think it's not really that angsty. It's just, you know, it's more difficult. Yeah, joy seems to be, you know, kind of a universal emotion, but, well, in script anyway, it's quite difficult. You know, if you're happy, you're happy.
Now, if I remember rightly, you were next, weren't you? Okay, we'll just get a microphone to you, thanks.
Obviously, your character's quite a complex character, and when you first read the script, did you, like, have a clear view of how you were going to play him, or did your character progress, like, slowly?
From what the film is to the first script, the script changed so much over, what was it, like 7 months or something? Mm-hmm. And just having loads and loads of rewrites and just talking to Nick and Alan, the director, and the writers, Will and Jenny, and just a lot. And I tried to kind of tailor things to what I was interested in. Like the relationship with the dad, I think, changed quite a lot, because I thought, when you're a young guy, one of your biggest fears is, you know, the sort of irrational fear of walking in your dad's footsteps and living the same life as him. And even if your dad's a good guy, you still kind of, you just want to assert your independence on everything, and it causes kind of irrational rages. But but it just sort of developed into something quite different and quite specific from the first reading. But I always felt pretty connected to it. I thought it was a great template at the beginning.
Because the guy who wrote this, it was Will, wasn't it?
Right.
And the character of Tyler was pretty much him, right?
He wanted to play it.
Yeah. When I first met him, he said, I can only do the movie. You can only produce the movie if I play the role.
Brilliant.
And then I dissuaded him from that pretty quickly. So,
I mean, he wrote it when he was, you know,
obviously evolved. Like, he's 27 now, but he wrote it when he was 22 to begin with. And I think, again, it comes from that place of just kind of trying to work out when you're a young man, young in your early 20s, who you are, and, you know, what, and young women as well, in terms of Ali, I think, you know, and what you want out of life. And I don't think those questions are necessarily very clear at that age.
That was the other thing about it, which is interesting about it, sorry, now you bring it up, about how it dealt with grief, which I noticed a lot of people are talking about, saying, like, you know, he doesn't deal with, and Tyler doesn't deal with grief in a... in the sort of typical way, you know, dealing with sorrow is this kind of noble emotion. I think grief when you're young can be very, like, cheap in a lot of ways, and I thought that was quite interesting, like, you know, how Tyler's, you know, he does want to forget about his past. It's like, I don't know why it was up, because now I'm just thinking about it. Sorry. Yeah.
So now, this lady here hasn't asked a question yet, so we'll go to her next, if we can get the microphone. Thank you.
Hi, it's Jessica David from Glamour. Rob, Tyler is quite an angry, punchy young man. I just wondered, how did you psych yourself up for the fight scenes, and have you ever been in a fight?
I haven't been in a fight for quite a long time. I'm too scared now. I think too many people are just like, I think I've got to a fight now, like, some probably just kill me just for the sake of it.
It's good that you can laugh about it.
I don't know. I mean, I a lot of it, you know, I liked a lot of the Tyler's character, that the kind of rebelliousness and the audaciousness of it, because it's, you know, it's kind of like fantasy of myself, you know. It's like, yeah, I'm the type of guy who just randomly gets into fights and gets it all the time. I'm not really.
I felt scared for you because on the day when we were filming the Chris Cooper fight, Chris was doing press-ups against the wall.
He's strong.
He's like, unbelievably strong. It's terrifying.
But, and also, the thing, the fight I had at the beginning, I was doing it with a big stunt guy, and was hitting a thing next to his head, and hit him what I thought was my full strength in his face about four times. And every time I hit him, I was like, I'm sorry. And he's like, it's fine, I can't it doesn't even really hurt. And so it was very, that was the kind of ego deflator.
You had another question, right? Do you want to just pass that in front? Thank you.
Yeah, when an Aussie and a Brit work so closely together, is this the backdrop for a shared sense of humour and perhaps a sporting rivalry or two?
I think the first...
Sorry, what do you
mean? No, we hadn't really ever heard about Vegemite and Primark.
On the day of the audition, because you got the part on the audition, right? We went out to a bar afterwards, and she like, and literally, I swear, Emily, who's the tiniest little girl, drank about 24 beers in front of me, and was stone cold sober afterwards. And I was just like, oh, okay, this is gonna be this is different. This is something for the character. I don't know what I'm talking about. So I've been up to 6 o'clock this morning.
The rivalry was all about food and drink then, not about sports?
No, I mean, I don't watch sports, so, yeah, that was cleared up easily. It's my sense of humour, though. I do think that Australia and Britain do share more of the same sarcasm in humour than...
I find her quite funny when she's not intending to be.
When I'm trying to be, though, it's just really bad.
Yeah. Understand when you're trying.
Okay, I think we've got time for one final question. This gentleman here, and then we'll have to call it a day.
Hi, I'd like to ask both Rob and Emily if they could tell me what their favourite type of biscuit is.
Wow, that's a great question. I've always wanted to know that, Rob, what your favourite type of biscuit is. Where are you from, by the way?
Screenjabber.
I like to think, do you know when they say in America you get like chicken and biscuits? It's just really funny how you get
it's like a scone.
Yeah, I've started to grow very attached to that, because I always drove past the restaurants and think like, chicken and biscuits? Like, why? And I had one the last time I was in America, and it was very nice. And so now I'm changing my opinion of what can be defined as a biscuit.
Well, we're looking for an actual brand now.
Well, we're promoting.
I do like the hobnob.
That's what you're after, right?
Yeah. And
yeah, I do. Maybe like Madeleine.
What's
that?
Very
Christian.
That's not a problem.
Yes, it is. Pepperidge Farms makes them in States.
Nicholas, join in on this.
Not looking for any endorsements for Pepperidge Farms.
Chocolate McBibbies for me.
What?
Chocolate McBibbies?
The dark chocolate ones,
not the milk chocolate.
No, that's digestive biscuits.
Well, that's kind of that.
But with chocolate on it, that's not...
We're really getting going with this now. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. Thank you, everybody. Give a round of applause.